So how many of you have had a big goal, a big dream, or something you wanted more than anything? Thank you. And how many of you have ever encountered some adversity along the way, some challenges or some obstacles, sometimes maybe things you thought you could never overcome? Thank you. My name's Scott Sargeant, and I'm here to talk to you today about the power of having a champion's mindset. My story begins in April of 1999. I was training for the Olympic team in the hammer throw event of track and field, and I'd worked my way into the top 10 of the US, and they take three for the Olympic team. So I was training and playing full out for that.
Again, your goal was to be part of the team in 1996 and hopefully medal in the year 2000.
Life was very full and you know, full of success and passion and drive, and I was lit up in what I was doing. You know, my athletic training, which, you know, typically was 20 to 30 hours a week, then working full-time as an engineer, so I had a lot going on. And my vision that I had for a relationship was extremely focused and a really, really high standard. And then I met this woman who actually met all of those criteria, and we fell into a very, you know, intense, passionate love affair and chose each other, you know, as being the one. Then, as sometimes happens, I got completely blindsided. I ended up breaking off the relationship after several weeks because it was so disrupting. I was still deeply and madly in love with that person, but it was too painful, and I wasn't able to reconcile those things that inside of myself. And after a little over a month, again, of not sleeping a wink, of not knowing any other way out of this, I'm not being willing to talk to anybody about it because I was super successful. I was this strong, powerful guy, you know, always in control. So on the evening of April 22nd of 99, things took a very dramatic turn, and I ended up going headfirst down a flight of concrete steps. I landed right on top of my head, ended up shattering two bones at the base of my neck, badly crushed my spinal cord. I ended up waking up in a hospital bed. I could look down, I could see my arms and legs, but I couldn't move them. Couldn't even feel. Not numb, just nothing. The doctors walked in and started to explain. I'd gone headfirst down a flight of concrete steps, landed on top of my head and shattered bones at the base of my neck, badly crushed my spinal cord, and was paralyzed from the neck down. Then they gave me a life sentence of quadriplegia. I'd never walk again. So this is now 19 years ago, and what I hadn't talked about for literally 18 years was that this so-called accident wasn't an accident. In fact, I never ever used that word. Never used that word, accident. Just like I said, I ended up going headfirst down a flight of steps. I didn't say I tripped, I didn't say I fell. Because in fact, it wasn't an accident. I intentionally dove headfirst down that flight of concrete steps, willfully kept my arms to my side with the intention of killing myself. Because of the intense emotional pain and trauma that got triggered for me in that romantic relationship. And I had this perception that if I went and talked to a medical doctor or a therapist or psychologist and told them what was really going on with me, that I would end up literally locked away in restraints and pumped full of drugs the rest of my life. Now, as the warrior that I was, that was something that I was totally unwilling to turn myself over to. And that might not have been the truth of what had happened, but it was my perception, which therefore made it my reality. Days later, when I woke up in the hospital, you know, through the fog of the meds and the painkillers and the anesthesia, you know, I definitely knew something was wrong. And on one level, you know, I hadn't expected to be here. And then I couldn't move, and I couldn't even feel, you know, my body, my limbs. And I had, in a way, done, you know, the ultimate give up of giving up on this life. And
one of the first things that flashed through my mind was, oh shit. And one of the next things was that, you know, I was being punished for what I tried to do. Literally my neck, my body was shattered, and my heart and my spirit were really kind of crumpled in that bed too. And here I was, 6'2", 240 pound, like strapping, strong, could take on anything in my physical body, broken. My coach called me on the phone, and literally the nurse had to hold the phone to my ear because I couldn't hold the phone. And he asked me, how are you doing?
I'm like, what do you mean, how am I doing? This is beyond my worst nightmare. Forget about the Olympics. They're saying I'm never gonna walk again. How terrible is this? How bad is this? How unbelievable is this? And in that moment, he had the nerve to challenge me. He said, are you gonna fight and make yourself well? Or are you gonna give up and quit? I was so pissed. I couldn't believe he was saying that. I hated him for that. I probably would have screamed an obscenity or hung up the phone, but this poor nurse, I didn't want to give her a heart attack. She's holding the phone because I couldn't even hold the phone in that moment. And in that inner rage and just not knowing what to do, I'd like to think that the champion in me, that Olympian in me, but probably also the engineer in face of that logic, the choice was clear. What came out of my mouth was, I'm gonna fight and make myself well. I'm gonna recover 100% and walk out of here.
And in the face of all that I was being told, by the doctors and the evidence and the experts, that you don't recover from this thing. We literally created this other possibility called Scott walking. How outrageous, how preposterous. But I'm so blessed in that if anyone was gonna do that, I kind of had this stacked deck. Because I had all that preparation, preloaded, I was able to immediately apply those things to that challenging situation.
And while straining more than any Olympic lifting I'd ever done, I finally got the faintest little flicker, my little finger. And once I got that, I knew I could build the rest of it back, bit by bit. So again, building on all those strategies from my training, applying it to this new challenge. I was able to walk out of the hospital under my own power after just 6 weeks.
And I personally have never seen anybody with this severe a neurologic deficit recover purely due to their own willpower, I believe.
It's this incredible triumphant victory, right? Right?
So for a number of years, I kept that hidden secret. And I shared this cool story, as I kind of now call it, the cool story, this incredible inspirational journey of me going from being a quadriplegic to fully recovering and going back to throwing the hammer and then running triathlons and hiking mountains, and now I'm taking up paddleboarding. It took years and years, and honestly over a decade, probably close to 15 years for me to start to even recognize the impact that was having in my life. Because the more I would speak and I would tell this story, all these other people would be so inspired and moved and acknowledging me, but I felt worse and worse inside. And so literally the words like guilt and shame hadn't really been part of my vocabulary. So it took a while for me to see that out picturing in my life and see the barriers that I was bumping up in my own expression and the things that I wanted to contribute. And so really my TEDx talk last year, 18 years after that injury, was when I set myself free from that vow of silence. And I shared the whole truth publicly for that first time. Even though that's still part of me and my life experience, it never will have the hold on me that it did before. I will always own it more than it will own me.
We've all gone through those challenging times. Sometimes things that you maybe have felt like you can't go on or you would never be able to resolve or get beyond.
one of the most courageous things that you can do is to tell the truth, you know, to ask for help. And as I say, stop suffering in silence. And in opening that up, not only do you have an access to truly being known in all of your humanity, but to some new possibilities, to some kind of healing, to something changing, and to getting love and support from other people. Because I believe fundamentally, you know, most people want to help others. We all have that deep heart and that compassion in that space. Reaching out for help, you are not only making available something new in your world, but you're giving someone else the opportunity to support and contribute to another human being. So in my speaking career, I most often refer to myself as an inspirational speaker, but I've thought a lot about it, and I have three distinctions around that. There's actually inspiration, motivation, and desperation. And in large part, that first place that I was at, it was in that place of desperation. I had to find a way out of that. It was intolerable for me to be in that place that I was. And so there was a desperation to find a way out. And once I was able to grab onto some of those handholds or those tools and distinctions that I had and get the support in making the choice, in focusing on that vision and then speaking it to make it even more real. So then I got to this state of motivation where I was able to harness these positive energy, this focus and drive, right? It's this more of a make it happen energy with motivation. But ultimately, the higher level of the aspiration that I would, you know, point to is the spot of inspiration, where you're connected with, you know, your dreams, your energy, your passion, your flow. But that's not always the easiest place to start. It's wonderful if you can be, and I think that gives us an access to some of our most extraordinary work and certainly some of the most enjoyable. But those don't always happen at the same time. So sometimes it's this point of desperation or motivation where we actually can harness and access different levels of ourselves.
One of my bigger contexts for my Olympic endeavor and dream was being an inspiration. And I found that through the life that I've lived, the story and the experience that I have, that I've been able to inspire people in a much wider and deeper level of humanity than I would have through even the Olympic arena. I feel like I won the gold medal in my life that's, you know, more impactful than any gold medal that was ever won in Olympic Games. I feel so humbled and blessed to still be here, to be able to share those experiences, to make a difference for you, literally save lives.
When you meet a certain person that does beyond what you expect, you begin to realize that there's something beyond your own skills that determines how a patient does, and whether that's their spirit or their heart or whatever term you want to use, it's there, it's real.
Well, always knowing that as human beings we're capable of so much more.
Hi, I'm Dan Safkow. I'm creator of the video that you just watched, and this is Shauna O'Hara. She's founder of the Scott Sargeant Foundation. Tragically, we lost Scott in September of 2021, but I do take a small measure of solace in knowing that he spent the last 22 years not only surviving, but thriving oftentimes in bringing his important message to the people. If you're someone who's at risk, or you, maybe you're supporting someone who's at risk, know that Scott always wanted more for others than he wanted for himself. So he wants you to take his information to heart so you can not only survive, but thrive for the rest of your life. And Shauna is going to support you in that by keeping his message and his work alive through the foundation. And Shauna, the foundation is built in part on Scott's mantra that he shared with all of us.
Scott's mantra for his friends or even the people that he came in contact with was always, how can I support you? So we're taking Scott's mantra and making it our motto. So the motto at the Scott Sargeant Foundation is, how can we support you? That support is through resources and tools to help you not only survive, but to thrive.
Thanks, Shauna. And if you'd like to keep in touch, and if you'd like to support Shauna's important work, if you're watching this right now on the Foundation website, please enter your name and email address in the box. If you're watching on social media, please click that link, go to the Foundation website, and enter your email address so you can keep in touch. And thanks in advance for your support of the Scott Sargeant Foundation.
Thank you.